This is the Clash of Empires exhibition, the 1879 Anglo-Zulu War. It's a combination of artifacts, letters, documents, and every other piece that we could bring physically from that moment in time that led up to that famous war in 1879 into one museum gallery. That's what this exhibition is. We are at the Royal Philatelic Society, London, right in the heart of the City of London. Specifically, this is the Speer Museum of Philatelic History. That's the named museum that's here at the Royal. And it's here because the postal artifact, letters and envelopes and things sent through the mail, are the central guiding artifact category across the entire narrative of the exhibition. And being here in the heart of where philately and postal history is studied at the oldest and longest continuously operating philatelic organization in the world is why it's here.
We were very keen with this exhibit that we should represent both perspectives. It's very easy, certainly in Great Britain, to fall into the trap of regarding this as redcoat history. But in fact, this was a British imperial intrusion into an independent country. And we thought it was very important to be able to represent how things were with the Zulus, what was going on with them at the time, where the British come from, the causes of the conflict. It was essentially a war forced on the Zulus by the British. And often in British Anglo-centric accounts, you find the story stops when the gun smoke clears, as if that's the end of it, nothing happens, the Britons withdraw, well, now what? Well, of course, there were consequences for the Zulu kingdom, which resulted in 10 years of conflict after British troops withdrew and shaped their future as they're facing up to the growing reality of imperial and colonial domination and then, of course, consequently, apartheid. So we thought it was very important to look at how they feel about these things now, and we've tried to represent that in the collection. And also, of course, we've got a number of guests who are coming along to give a different perspective, the Zulu perspective on it. And we'd like to think that we've been as even-handed with it as we can, but of course there's always room to improve these things.
There's two things, King Shala and the Battle of San Juan. Those two are just something like an identity, the Zulu nation. You talk about King Shala, then you talk about Isandlwana. Well, Isandlwana, you remember that behind Isandlwana, we've got King Cetshwayo. But I mean, these two, when you talk about them, somebody will start to understand who you are. This exhibition is just a very, very important thing. It's a huge step trying to bring attention. Anglo-Zulu War is a fascinating subject, especially now here in Great Britain, because we've got so many people coming out to South Africa to visit these famous battlefields. There was a demand because people began to say, we know only one side of the story. We would like to get now from the Zulu perspective. Isandlwana is a big thing, not only for the Zulus now, although at the time it was just more for the Zulus. Their pride, having defeated such a powerful army in the world, that bravery. And it became an example to many African people later on that if Zulus achieve this at Isandlwana, why can't we? And many people began to refer to what happened at Isandlwana whenever they come across challenges like, you know, being colonized. And they began to say, no, let's try, because Zulus did it. Why can't we? And it's a big example that whoever you are as a Zulu, that kind of pride and also that bravery, fighting, you know, for the king, fighting for the kingdom, fighting for what you believe is right, you know. An example.
At Cherrystone, we're proud to partner with Alex on his vision for this exhibition and bringing his vision to reality here in London. His exhibition is beautiful, it's interesting, it's informative, it's fascinating to look at, and the participation so far has far exceeded my wildest expectations, and I'm just so happy to be a part of this. So I know Alex for close to 20 years now, and he's always had a vision for philately, and he's always been at the forefront of our hobby, and it's a vision that I really admire and can get behind. So his interest in the Zulu War has started philatelically with two-dimensional objects, cover stamps, and the like, and he's really branched out into three dimensions. He's got shields, he's got displays, he has artifacts, but it's the bridging of the two-dimension into three-dimension that I really think is the future of philately and incorporating it into the modern world.
When you're trying to tell a story focused on any aspect of history, and you're using or wanting to use artifacts to do that, in this exhibition, we focus on every category and medium of artifact that we could get a hold of. Now, the postal artifact is the one guiding medium of artifact across all the chapters, all the sections of this story. It is the most directly attributable artifact at any point of the story to a particular place, a particular time, moment, person. And it is physically something from that place, from that moment. And getting someone's ideas that they were writing to whoever about is physically in that piece of paper or from that envelope or that letter. Now, side by side with these postal artifacts are three-dimensional artifacts and other two-dimensional artifacts, photographs, etc., that are across every other category. When we think about wanting to sort of take a snapshot of any place, like a restaurant. Let's say you have lunch today, and you want to collect that moment, that day, 100 years from now, what would you want? What would you need? Well, you would want the menu that you would use for ordering. You might want the tablecloth. You might want the sign outside of the restaurant itself. You might want photographs of the other diners, of yourself eating there. You might want piece of the food of some in some way that you could preserve for 100 years. You might want the plates. You might want a piece of the wallpaper. All these are different examples of how you would tell that story, some two-dimensional, some three-dimensional, but it's all important. Well, no matter what area you collect or what area you study or what area you focus on, having just one slice, one category of artifact as a way of wholly telling that story isn't really enough. So whether it's the postal collector or student, the letters were not the only thing on campaign. They weren't sitting there naked in the middle of a field with no furniture, nothing, and just writing letters on a stump. No, they had uniforms. They had kit with them. They had vehicles. They had wagons. They had horses. There were people around them. Things were happening. And all those things had artifacts, at least as we think about them today, but really stuff or material, physical elements to that campaign, both on the Zulu side and on the British side, or in any area of military history in particular. Additionally, when they're wearing their uniforms and so, or when they're wearing their medals or whatever it may be, well, they were doing things. And one of the most principal unifying elements that all, in this case, British soldiers and colonial soldiers were doing, whether they were General Chelmsford, you know, the most senior commander, all the way to the lowly private, they were all, or many of them, were writing letters. So it's also the postal artifact is that piece that actually connects from the one penny concessionary rate, you know, sort of intentionally low cost given to the private soldier, all the way to that 6 pennies that it cost a general to send a letter. They all were connected by wanting to touch this postal part. And so again, that's why the postal element, again, here at the Royal Philatelic Society of London, why this museum exhibition is here, is that it is the thing that democratically, in a way, connects all of the participants, and certainly on the British and colonial side, where letter writing and writing was a part of culture. Very different than the physical artifacts that, though everyone had elements of kit, etc., it's harder to sort of tie them all together as one unifying category that everyone used.
I'm delighted to lend my support to the Royal Philatelic Society of London as it opens a window onto one of the most significant chapters in the shared history of the Zulu and British nations, the 1879 Anglo-Zulu War.
This exhibition begins with words of welcome from Prince Makuzutu Buthelezi, and his words are what give the framing for everything we see here in this gallery, all these three-dimensional and two-dimensional physical artifacts of the Anglo-Zulu War and its history and context. It all starts with his words, and that's what really where it all begins.
It was truly a clash of empires. I welcome you to this very remarkable exhibition. Thank you.
So the first weekend, we had over 200 visitors come to the society, which is fantastic. I would really kind of classify the visitors into two different types of visitors. We have the people who are a follower of Ian's work and have read his work, or know Alex or any of like the study groups for the Anglo-Zulu War, and they have just been enthused about this exhibit. I feel like this exhibition has been very popular, and a lot of people have been looking forward to this for a long time. And then, so those are probably our, right now, our most concentrated area of visitors. Then we also have another type of visitor who just kind of stumbled upon this exhibit by accident, probably just like from saw the banner in the street or saw it advertised somewhere on social media or in the press. And they've been very receptive to the exhibit, even if it's something they're not entirely familiar with. Personally, my favorite visitors have been the kids who've been here, just because This is probably a very new concept to them, and I think learning about it through an exhibit like this, especially if it's a very spontaneous visit, is really the perfect way to do so.
A lot of these guys are very, very keen. I mean, we've had people here who've read a lot of the history, people been here to the battlefields. We had somebody who came along who said, oh, my great-great uncle, if he's watching this, forgive me if I've got the relationship wrong, but was a drummer killed at the Battle of Isandlwana, and the family have got his medal. And they actually had a picture of that chap's father, who'd served in the Crimean War, wearing his own Crimean War medals, but on the other side of his chest, as was the habit at the time, his son's medal, who was killed at Isandlwana. So we found family members coming along, and generally so far everybody's been very positive. People have found all sorts of different things interesting. We've had Lindiswe Ngubez here, whose own forebears fought in the Battle of Isandlwana, and it's been really nice to have people ask him questions. Well, how does the story work from your side of the fence, and what do you think about it now? What's it like to be on the battlefield as a tour guide, to live there now and encounter people? And it's interesting. And we've had actually one thing that slightly surprised me is the kind of range of international visitors we've had. Majority, obviously, from here in the UK, but we've had Americans, we've had South Africans. I think there was somebody from Scandinavia. So this story has quite a wide appeal. And obviously, our objective is this stage, get as many people through to see the artifacts and to explore the story from that perspective.
We are very fortunate to have in partnership with two very fine, actually in the wargaming space, but they've taken their war games and made them two dioramas for us, one of the Battle of Rorke's Drift and the other of the Battle of Entombe. We knew the dioramas would, having at least a diorama of some kind was a requirement of this exhibition, because as old style as it may seem, because dioramas were a thing of museum exhibitions and museum exhibits, permanent museum exhibits, almost from truly another century ago, from the 19th century and earlier, but throughout the 20th century was sort of the must-have accompaniment, interpretation type thing you would see at a museum exhibition, especially where anything related to a military conflict was in play. But the people that you would stereotypically think would be the least interested in it, say a young person, who you think about technology and digital this and, but actually, the young people that came through on our opening day, this was one of the most fascinating parts of the whole room. In an attempt to have as close to scale as possible, these are two very confined engagements. One that takes place on the January 22nd, right after the Battle of the Santa Juanas, the attack on the mission station right across the border in Natal. So that's the focus of Diorama 1. And Diorama 2 is the Battle of Ntoma, which takes place in the sort of intermediate period of the war before the reinvasion has really gotten underway. A Zulu force attacks a supply wagon train, basically, with a detachment of soldiers from the 80th Regiment as they're trying to cross an overflowing river, and they basically attack on both sides and defeat the British force there and kill most of the soldiers. So an attempt to show a very famous part of the war from a popular imagination, popular awareness, and then a much less well-known engagement from a little bit later in the war, but to show a British, quote, victory and a Zulu victory. The Battle of the Santa Juana, if shown in a scaled-down form, would be like a 30 or 40-foot-long diorama because of how large that battlefield is. So that's not possible to show here in this context, but so that's the two dioramas.
I've been writing and researching professionally for about 30 years. I've been interested since I was a kid, funnily enough. My interest, like a lot of people in Great Britain, started seeing the movie Zulu when I was 7 or 8 years old in 1964. And that raised all sorts of questions in my mind. What is this story, this extraordinary visual image of Zulu warriors standing over dead redcoats lying in the African veldt? And I just thought, what on earth is that all about? And I spent most of my life then trying to find out.
So the film Zulu is a lot of people's first point of call when it comes to Zulu history. So they see the film first, and then they get interested in the history of the film, and then they get interested in the history of Africa, Southern Africa, Anglo-Zulu War.
These are the days and nights of fury and honor, of courage and cowardice, that an entire century of empire-making and filmmaking can never surpass.
When I was 13, I was taken onto the battlefields at Rorkestrift and Isandlwana by my father, and spent 2 or 3 days walking around. And in those days, can't happen now, but in those days, we were walking around the battlefields picking up bullets, picking up buttons, picking up belt buckles, picking up little relics from the actual battle. It was like a free-for-all back in the 70s. So that's what I did. I got hugely interested in this Zulu history because I grew up in South Africa. I grew up in Johannesburg. It inspired me to learn more. And in those days, there was no television in South Africa per se. And I had a 16mm projector, and I used to go around to the local shop and hire a 16mm film, come back and watch it. And my dad told me about this film called Zulu, which I hadn't heard of before when I was 13. I knew nothing about it whatsoever. We hired Zulu on 16mm. I took it home, I screened it, and I basically fell in love with history. I fell in love with Zulu history. And I know that the film is a Hollywoodized version of history, but it was hugely entertaining. It was so beautifully made. Fantastic performances by Stanley Baker, Michael Caine, Jack Hawkins, everybody attached to that film. Cy Enfield did an amazing job. My love for Zulu history was born then, I think. Besides walking on the battlefields, which was inspiring, watching the film, made me want to go back to the battlefields, but also was a huge influence in me wanting to be a filmmaker.
Recognize that though this is here really in just a temporal moment, just for the month of July in 2023, we've spent a lot of time leading up to this physical exhibition to make sure that what is seen here will be seen in varying forms well after this is done. And that includes our YouTube channel at Clash of Empires, and also a 372-page book that we've been working very hard on for for many years, that also has every single artifact that's on display physically here in this gallery is depicted and described in that book. And then what happens next to the physical exhibition and where will this go after this? You know, time will tell. Stay tuned.